Alright, so last time we finally closed off a new chunk of land, which I actually forgot to show on camera, so here it is. But while we were out expanding, our oil buffer level was dropping fast and our oil reserves are already dangerously low. This is very bad, because if we run out, our eternal barbecue party will be finished and the biters will be in my walls. And our main oil source cannot even support a single refinery anymore, so we need to go out and claim our second oil source. This is a move we had already foreseen, and we have got power, a raider and anti-expansion pipes already in place. All we gotta do is make the pump jacks, drive out there while doing my signature moves of greeting little Johnny, crash full speed ahead into yet another rock. Build the pump jacks, encase it in our trademark Wall Defense 2000, complete with its own repair bot network, power it up, and wait for the flamethrowers to fill up with oil. Before we head back and connect it into the back of our original oil source, we make sure to always leave a near full tank of oil behind for this place to defend itself, should it get cut off somehow in the future. And once we connect the new oil field to the old one, we set another wire condition, which makes sure the new oil field will only help out if the old oil field cannot keep up with our demand. Now, in practice, this will be virtually always, but as oil fields are infinite, it's always a good idea to prioritize depleted oil fields over new ones. Anyway, that solves our potential oil crisis, I hope. So under the cover of the dark night, we sneak back through the wastelands, hoping to safely reach our base before the chilling sound of gnawing teeth comes too close by. Back at the base, our power plant really needs an upgrade. So we simply attach another half of the existing power plant to the back, increasing it from 20 boilers and 40 steam engines to 30 boilers and 60 steam engines. Now wait a minute, you may say, that won't work, you cannot have more than 20 boilers in a line. Well, that's not completely accurate. You cannot feed more than 20 boilers with a single offshore pump. So we just use two offshore water pumps instead of one, and after combining the water production of the pumps, we make sure to keep the individual pipe segments very short by using some in-between pumps. As we still didn't find the time to extend bot coverage to our new land, we manually repaired this wall on the way out. Wait, on the way out? To where? Well, now with our shiny new oil source, I feel we can afford yet another eternal barbecue party. It won't even cost me that much oil, as this corner was under almost continuous attack already anyway. At least by extending our wall corner to be practically on top of the biter base, the biters will just trickle in continuously, instead of choosing to build up into a big blob from time to time. Unfortunately, that means we also creep up close by on this nest here. But that's not a big deal either, as we are planning to cross south of the biter base even more close by the nest. As we cannot simply make the usual rectangular base in this playthrough, we also had to make an inside corner blueprint to use here. Rectangular bases are popular because, well, bots are stupid really. Because bots always fly the shortest straight line to their target, they will fly outside the base walls and die while flying straight over enemy nests if you include inside corners in your base. And as another bot will just immediately pick up the task of any destroyed bot, this may lead to a cascade effect, where you will just lose all of your bots as they will keep trying and dying in the same damn place. Our base will be even worse than having just an inside corner here and there. We already have two worms inside of our walls, and we will literally need to expand around the biter bases, so eventually our base is gonna look more like a Swiss cheese, with very aggressive holes. So, to summarize, yeah, I have no idea how I'm going to keep the walls up and repaired, man. Alright, progress. And more progress. We added yet a third eternal barbecue party on this flank. We have plenty of oil anyway. Look, my new oil field isn't even contributing. The pump jacks are idle and the tank is full. My old oil field can keep up just fine. Wait, why is my giant oil buffer tank almost empty? Oh, whoops, the oil pipeline got sabotaged by a sneaky biter. They are starting to take advantage of the fact that not only am I growing insensitive to the something got destroyed sound, but also Factorio's flamethrower sounds take up a lot of sound slots, and they often drown out or even completely block other sounds from being played. So to summarize, that could easily lead me to not noticing a critical breakdown like this one until it's too late. I wouldn't have caught this one either if I hadn't done a quick visual inspection of the oil fields and storage. Good catch, man. I will quickly fix that off cam, while you can watch me trying to invent a new way to neutralize these biters. There's no way I can peacefully wall in those guys, I don't think. We're going to have to think of something completely different. Now, the highest level worms in here are medium worms, and they have 30 range. That is the same range as our longest range turret, the flamethrower. So we can visualize the worm's maximum distance with the flamethrower's range overlay. But we won't be using flamethrowers here. Instead, we will use laser turrets. They only have 25 range, but that's alright. We don't need to shoot down any worms or nests, we just gotta kill the moving enemies. Meanwhile, our expansion's wall is falling into disrepair quickly all over the place. We shouldn't hold off too long on repairing those walls. We all know what happened last time I underestimated the biter attack strength. Anyway, by placing a belt ghost next to the medium worm, we can then make a blueprint of the belt and the laser turret to measure out the correct safe distance on the other three sides of the worms. And we proceed to encase their base in laser turrets. Yeah, I'll see myself
out. Now, the west side of their base lacks the protective medium worms, which means initially our laser turrets are in range of the closest biter base. And ain't that a pretty sight? Unfortunately, this pretty sight comes with an astronomical power usage cost, which we simply cannot afford. Yet. So, for now, we need to push back the wall just a little further, so our laser turrets can only target the moving enemies. I figure a single wall should be enough, as the laser turrets apply their damage at the speed of light, rather than the speed of fire, and even if the biters breach the wall, the laser can shoot at point blank, and they are omnidirectional, so they won't exactly become sitting ducks like our flamethrowers earlier. But yeah, we'll have to see if this works out like I think it will. Now, unfortunately, we didn't achieve either of the two goals we set out for by encasing this biter base. The coal peninsula is still out of reach thanks to this annoying medium worm here, who can reach all the way to the shoreline. And the other goal of making a nice straight wall down to the peninsula, well, yeah, that ain't gonna happen either, as we cannot move either wall in the right direction. Oh well, at least it appears that our laser cage will work well enough, for now. Until behemoth biters will enter the scene at 90% evolution. So, that leads me to having to make yet another abomination in the form of this crooked wall over here. After we draw down the flamethrowers to fully close off our new area from the outside world, it really is the highest time to go and fix our perimeter wall before the biters break through again. And whoops, another unplanned bot flyout. Just kidding, this time it was planned. By moving in range to let the bots fly out from my power armor, but then moving out of range again before they start repairing the wall and taking damage in the fire, we can prevent the bots from getting stuck in an infinite repair loop while getting barbecued. Unfortunately, this method only works with our mobile power armor based personal roboports. This method cannot be done with the static area provided by the land-based roboports. Anyway, after somewhat safely repairing these two heavily assaulted walls, we can fully safely walk by right next to these neutralized enemy spitter spawners. Before patching up the northernmost wall. Thank you. before dropping down past our very first barbecue party just outside our base walls. Somehow a giant group of spitters is building up on the lakeside. They are completely ignoring our eternal flamethrower fire and gathering up for a full strength attack on our base. What is this? Rampant? Anyway, this is our base now, forever under attack at many points simultaneously. And despite just having fixed the entire wall, the biters already bust the first layer again. We really need to get up some Roboport coverage somehow. Well, at least we got plenty of supplies for that after the time-consuming task of expanding our walls to increase our not quite entirely personal space. So out we go, placing the first Roboport and providing it with repair packs. Will they be able to repair the walls without getting blasted by the acid or burned to a crisp? Well, it seems so. So let's provide the northern wall with repair packs too. Okay, abort, abort. The worms are too aggressive, it seems, and they'll lock the bots into an infinite repair loop until they get destroyed by the worms. But perhaps the initial damage to the walls was just too great to overcome. So let's fix it up manually. And re-enable the bots. Perhaps they'll be able to keep up and escape the worms if the wall is never in a severely damaged state. It doesn't seem so. We need to try a different solution, so we draw inspiration from the tech company Apple. No repairs, replacements only. So we reclaim all the repair packs, providing the bots with replacement walls only, and no repair packs at all. The problem is, the bots themselves get damaged by the fire and acid during their missions, and with no repair packs, the bots cannot repair each other. But do they need to? Well, it turns out they don't. As this clearly damaged bot returns to the Roboport, it appears to fully heal itself upon entering the Roboport. That means we do not need repair packs to maintain the bot's condition. And technically, we do not need repair packs for the walls either. Instead of the dangerous and time-consuming repairs at the walls, we can just let the walls wear down completely. And only have the bots fly out to quickly plop down a new wall piece when a wall is fully destroyed. This also prevents them from flying out and trying to repair each other, while being burned from below by fire and burned from above by acid. The fact that the bots automatically repair themselves upon entering the Roboport, even without repair packs being present, is great news, as my initial experiments show that the great repair plan is just an unsustainable approach. The laser and case phase was a fun strategy to pull off, so we repeat it once more on this nest over here. Meanwhile, we can see that the no repairs, replace only strategy is working well, as the bot can instantly drop the wall and make its escape. Well, escape off cam, I guess, as we just lost a laser turret. It turns out our new zoo has a weak point, in the form of getting attacked in the back by untamed wildlife from a nearby northeastern nest. So, as a temporary measure, we place a few extra laser turrets and wall off both sides in the northeast corner. Alright, here's a better example of the replace and run strategy of the bots. Nice. Meanwhile, we have already amassed over 120 unrepaired walls on our multiple fronts. And an annoying side effect of the no repairs replace only strategy is that the game will constantly remind us that we are out of repair packs. Well, if you are a regular viewer, you are already used to the attack button blinking all the effing time anyway, so I guess you'll survive. Another annoying side effect is that walls are constantly breaking, scaring me with alert sounds multiple times per minute. But with my luck, the one time something really important gets destroyed, of course somehow I'll miss it. Anyway, we extend our base wall south, turning west high enough so that our flamethrowers cannot accidentally burn down our laser turrets. And behold my beautiful base. We have claimed a lot of ground, annoyed a lot of biters, but did we really achieve anything? We failed to claim the coal peninsula we set out to claim, and in the north and south we didn't claim any new resources at all really, except for a little bit of stone. Meanwhile, more biter expansions have probably denied us access from other resources further outside our base walls. We can now build a giant factory with all of our empty space, but that won't help us much if we don't have any resources to feed our factory. Somehow I feel I'm playing this game wrong.